about this?
Hey, you should have done this.
There are some bodies that might even look okay next to mine.
No, you don't have number 81 on your chest. Your chest is probably 81.
So the kickoff delayed slightly here at Hampden Park, but I don't think anybody's going to complain about that.
No, I don't think so. It looks like the rain's holding off. It looks like it's going to be a great day for football. And looking forward to good things from both Scott Couper and the Claymores.
We've seen this in the past down the years here in NFL Europe. You get to week 10 and people say some teams, they're dead, they're just waiting to go home. And yeah, there are guys waiting to go home. But they really do pick it up for this last week of the season. And Pete Kuharchek has certainly had his guys very focused. He said he's not interested in tiebreakers or anything like that. He just wants to get out of this game with the win.
Right, and I think the interesting thing about these last games is you have some teams who are in the World Bowl hunt, you have some that aren't. You find out a lot about your players in a game like this.
And Pete Dahlquist says, well, his fellas just want to put in another big effort today. Want to finish the season on a high, don't you? You know, even if you can't go anywhere, you want to finish with a win.
Well, you do, because it's the last thing you remember. You're going to your off season, and you want to leave with a good taste in your mouth.
Well, Orion Fire won the toss, and they will receive. So Jordan Younger and Dwight Carter on the return. Ben Carter, 86. Younger, who's ripped off one or two this season. We are just about ready for the final act of the season as far as the Scottish Claymores are concerned. Holliman's kick is underway. It is fielded at the 7 by Jordan Younger. And Younger reaches the 20 before he's touched, and then he's touched and crunched by Vaughan Sanders. So out comes Phil Stambaugh, allocated here from the New Orleans Saints. He beat out Giovanni Carmazzi for the starting job, but really has had some problems the longer the season has gone on. And you can see the quarterback rating the worst in NFL Europe. The line in front of him, Daniels, Bailey, Early, Nick O'Brien, who had a touchdown last week, and John Flick. The right side is the strength. And it's the right side they'll run behind. Andre Cooper and Michael Lewis, the wideout. Two tight ends, Newman and Huggins, Pepe Pearson. Is in the backfield. Stambaugh will throw on first down. He gets it away just as he was hit, and it's batted away by Nate Terry. They were looking in the direction of Michael Lewis. So let's take a look at this Scottish Claymores defense. The big three up front have been there all year. Chris Ward, Antonio Dingle, and Jabbar Threets. Familiar faces at linebacker as well, with Brooks and Dunlap outside, Miller and Renfro inside, Nate Terry and Jermaine Smith, a pair of Seahawks on the corners, Reggie Hunt and Eric Whitfield at the safeties. Second down and 10 from the 25-yard line. They'll go on the ground this time. Pepe Pearson looking to run inside, and he'll pick up three and no more than that. Jabbar Threets was in on the stop. Jamal Brooks was there as well, and it'll be third down and 7.
And again, a very predictable come out by the Rhein Fire offense. They tried to go down to Mike Lewis. He has a little bit of speed, and then a running play.
Yes, these two teams between them have not been productive. Offensively, the Fire, of course, have had that tremendous defense. No doubt we'll be talking about that later on. Third and 7. Stambaugh will throw. He has plenty of time, and it's tipped away by Jermaine Smith. They were looking for Andre Cooper. Three and out for the Rhein Fire, and we have an injured player down on the field, and it looks like it might be John Flick. And if it is Flick, he's the right tackle, and he's been the anchor of this offensive line.
It's the, the right side really is the strength of this offense, and whenever they've had success, it's going off the right side. If they lose Blick to an injury, it'd be a big blow, because all of a sudden you're down to 6 or 7 offensive linemen in this league.
What a blow this is for John Blick, possibly the last game of the season as well before he returns to the Kansas City Chiefs. You hate to see this.
But the thing with NFL Europe is you have another 3 to 4 weeks before these training camps open. Talk to these players, most of them feeling good coming into this game. You'd hate to see an injury or a serious injury really hamper his chance to make a roster next training camp.
He was holding his knee as well. It was Blick, which so often afflicts you offensive linemen. We've seen that down the years, and fingers crossed for John Blick. But that leaves them very thin now on the offensive line.
You see him right over here at right tackle. He's doing a nice job pass protecting. And what happens so often when you're at the tackle position is it's not even your guy that causes the injury. Somebody else falls into you and can really hurt your knee, your ankle, things like that. We'll wait and see what the bench has to say about how serious his injury is.
We'll wait and see who comes in at right tackle as well. Meanwhile, Rodney Williams will punt it away. Dante Hall waits at his 25-yard line. They came after Williams and got a touch on him. And lucky not to get a flag there. And it takes a great Rhein fire bounce as well, all the way down to the 25-yard line. So it's the turn of the Scottish Claymores offense to take the field, led by another quarterback that's had his problems this year, a teammate of yours, Dale Clint Stoerner of the Dallas Cowboys. And he too has been very up and down, as the offense indeed has. Humphrey Mack and King, Chris Watton and Craig Rabin getting starts on the right side today. And Scott Couper playing his last ever game, along with Dante Hall of the wideouts, Randy Palmer and James Whalen, the tight ends. Anthony Gray is in the backfield. First down from the 26-yard line. They'll go on the ground with Anthony Gray, who finds a big hole and gets a block as well. And Gray falls forward and will pick up 11 yards against a run defense that is formidable. Julian Duncan, Daniel Greer, Kelly Gregg and Bastian Lana, the big German, are the quartet up front. The anchor, Scott Zimmerman, flanked by Mike Sands and Jamel Smith, the linebackers, two Rams in that group, and a ball-hawking secondary, Harris and Mallard, the corners, Deke Cooper and Clarence LeBlanc, the safeties. All of them have made big plays this year. They'll keep it on the ground with Anthony Gray, and Gray not quite as productive this time. He'll pick up maybe three. Daniel Greer was certainly in on the stop there, the big number 98, and it'll be second and seven.
A couple more changes on the offensive line this week, Nick. We saw last week where they changed their center. They moved Jay Humphrey to left tackle. They move Eric King to center. The offensive line is a group that needs cohesiveness. They need to work together. They need to practice together. Scotland has not had that. Consequently, the running game has suffered throughout the year.
And Anthony Gray has checked out. And Vaughn Sanders is in the backfield now as well. Dante Hall is the motion man. Stoerner will throw, and he's got James Whalen, the tight end, who is tackled first by Corey Harris. Then okay. Mike Sands came along to offer some help. And they're a couple of yards short of the first down.
They look awful good. They look crisp coming out. Clint Stoerner draws back in the pocket, throws the ball on time. And when you give him time and you give him and Whalen time to work together, they are going to hurt you. Clint is a guy who needs a little bit of confidence. You get a couple short passes out there to start the game, and he can get into a rhythm. If he doesn't get into a rhythm, he struggles throughout the whole game.
Two guys you'll be seeing a lot of, and everybody moved there. And everybody threw a flag. Everything moved but the ball, I think, Dale. Which happens sometimes, doesn't it?
It does.
And I don't know how they're going to work this one out. Pete Morelli is our referee.
Before the snap, false start, number 61 in the offense. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Well, they threw it on Chris Watton, who's making his first start of the season at guard.
What tends to happen, Nick, when you have a short yardage situation, you want, the quarterback senses, hey, I want to go a quick count. I want to get the ball going. What happens, though, the defense says, that you know, they'll call out their defense. The lineman is thinking, first sound he hears, he's moving on.
Well, this is a bad situation for both these teams. Neither has excelled in third down. But a third and two is a tricky third and seven now. And Stoerner forced to throw and can't find Dante Hall. And the Claymores offense will check out. So the flag proved costly indeed.
It did. Anytime you go from third and one to third and six, your percentages go way, way down against any defense, but especially a defense as good as Rhein.
Brad Costello has had a terrific season. The man allocated here from the Patriots. Jordan Younger waits at his 15-yard line. He is averaging 8.2 yards return. Another beauty. Will go straight into the end zone. Not a hope of a return there. So each team has had one possession. We've had one first down, two punts, no scores early here at Hampden. Welcome back to Hampden Park in Glasgow, the season finale for the Scottish Claymores. The Rhein Fire, of course, hoping for one more game after this. They've got to win here and then hope other things go their way as well if they want to be in the championship game. And here's Phil Stambaugh. It was three and out last time. He will throw, he has lots of time, and he's got himself a man, and it's the dangerous Michael Lewis that takes it all the way into midfield. Nate Terry on the stop. Lewis is the guy that can really stretch this offense.
He is. He's their speed guy. He's the guy who Joe Clark told us yesterday they're going to try and take a few shots downfield, use his speed. Now he's stepping in. They're missing Eddie Hardaway today, their leading receiver, but they expect Mike Lewis to step up and come up with a few big plays.
Brian Connolly is in a right tackle, it looks like, for the injured John Blick. First down from midfield. They'll go on the ground. Pepe Pearson spins off to the right, runs into Jamal Brooks.
Here we go, man.
And picks up three. Well, some of our coaches and players are wearing mics for us today. It's a feature of games in NFL Europe that we can put microphones on people. There's Joe Clark, the offensive coordinator of the Rhein Fire. He's wired up. So too is Phil Stambaugh, and on the other sideline, Gene Darquist and Clint Stoerner. You love all this, don't you, Dale?
Oh, I'd love to sit here and hear the coaches, because it's something that you don't get when you're watching the NFL at home on Sunday.
In Scotland territory at the 47-yard line, Stambaugh will throw. The pressure comes from the outside, and now they've got him on the other side. And he'll go down. It looked like Rob Flickinger, the Englishman, was the first guy there. Sack number five on the season for a guy who only had two in four seasons coming in.
But you're going to see the pressure come over here on your right side. Now, what's happening is Scotland goes from a three-man line to a four-man line, back and forth. You're going to see Casey Tisdale come off the edge, completely unblocked, put the pressure on Stambaugh, make him step up. That three-man, four-man line causes confusion for the Rhein offensive line.
Tisdale and Doug Miller in on that tackle as well. A loss of three, it's third and 10, and Stambaugh from the gun gets it off. He was clobbered as he threw it, and a flag came in immediately. Stambaugh wearing a microphone, and we heard that hit up here.
He did get clobbered. Looked like Earl Riley might have came in a little bit late.
He is a fearsome hitter, Riley, but was this a legal
holding
hit?
Holding, number 78 offense.
Yes, it was.
Penalty is declined, fourth down.
Because it goes against left tackle Ashun Daniels. That was a painful play, that, for the Rhein Fire in every sense.
Well, it definitely is, and what you see happening is both offenses struggling, kind of like we thought would happen coming into the game, because both defenses are playing very well.
It means we're going to see plenty of the punters today, I suspect, and the punt returners. Rodney Williams from the Giants will punt to Dante Hall of the Chiefs.
Watch those hands!
Another terrific punt. Williams, well, it goes in the end zone, just a little bit too much on it, but it does mean no chance of a return, and it means that Stoerner will take over from his own 20-yard line. So maybe we'll get a chance to listen in on the play.
Hey, Jake. Huddle up. Let's go, fellas. Let's go, deuce left. Fake 93. Naked right arrow.
On one, ready?
Yeah.
Fake 93, naked right. You're going to see Clint Stoerner. He's going to hand off. Every bit of action is going to go over to your left. He's going to keep the ball, roll out right, and look downfield to complete a pass.
There it is. And there's the play, and it's brought in somehow by James Whalen. And James Whalen picks up 5 yards with Clarence LeBlanc in coverage. Here's a guy going into your camp this summer in Dallas. And with what he's done here this year, he must have a shot.
He's done such a wonderful job. You're going to see Whalen, he's going to come out late. Stoerner makes a great play, just getting rid of the ball. The pressure on him by Julian Duncan. The teams here in Europe run the naked bootleg so much, the defenses really are looking for it.
Get hunt. White 98.
Second down and five.
White 98, hunt.
Stoerner will throw again, straight down the middle this time for the other tight end, Randy Palmer. And he'll pick up 7 yards and a first down. Anthony Dogme, the German linebacker, on the stop.
Again, like I said earlier, Clint Stoerner is a guy who, if you get him some confidence early, he's going to come out and play a good game. You see him throw the ball right there with confidence, accuracy, and a lot of velocity. Fit the ball in there. Palmer made a nice catch. Scotland's moving the ball.
Is it Hunt?
So first down, number 37.
Wide 98, Hunt!
Back on the ground with Anthony Gray, and Gray runs into trouble.
Here we go, we're done!
Well, Gray gashed him for 11 yards on his first carry, 3 on his second, and now he's down to 1 on that one.
Raptor!
So this run defense of the Rhein Fire is sorting itself out, number 1 in the league.
Very strong defense going against the running game again that has struggled all year. This game is going to come down to who makes the fewest mistakes. Scotland does not want to turn the ball over.
Gerald Williams to the left, Corey Allen to the right. Scott Couper is the slot receiver.
Wide 98, Hunt!
Gonna have some time, and he goes for Whalen, and Dogme will tackle Whalen for no gain, but we have flags again.
Here we go.
So we will hear from Pete Morelli again.
Nick, it is so hard for teams in this league to run screens.
There is no penalty on the play. Remember, an eligible receiver went downfield, but the pass was behind the line of scrimmage. Third down.
They actually lost a couple on that play.
The thing about screens is it's a timing thing. You need to practice it. Everybody needs to be on the same page. The offensive linemen need to be able to act like it's a pass. You don't have that time over here. Consequently, the screens really struggle. You watch it on film, time after time, teams get thrown for losses or incomplete passes.
Whalen in the slot, Williams left, Cooper right. Third and 10.
Wide 98, Hunt!
Stoerner just manages to get it off, and now he's looking for Randy Palmer and can't find him, and there's no flags, it's incomplete. Clarence LeBlanc was draped all over Palmer. Man who has three intercepts returned for touchdowns this year.
You're going to see right over here, the pressure is going to come from the left side of the screen. Jim Stoll working on Bastian Lano. Lano puts an inside move on. Consequently, Clint Stoerner has to force himself out of the pocket, throw the ball on the run, and you're not as accurate when you're running with the ball as you are when you're standing there.
So the field position battle continues. The pressure now on Brad Costello to do his bit. He's got another good kick away that is hanging there, but there's a chance of a return here for Younger. And Younger's found a seam up the middle, and he'll get to the 29-yard line before he's stopped by Lonnie Mitchell, still scoreless here at Hampden Park in Glasgow. Back to Hampden Park in Glasgow, Nick Halling with Dale Hellestray, and it's a tradition here, Dale, on the last day of the season. All the Claymore staff wear kilts. They all get kilted up, quite literally, and our producer, Fran Morrison, tried to get us to wear kilts today, and we said, forget that. Well, you did.
Well, you know what? Yesterday, talking to Jackie, their PR director, I said, is there any way you could get me a kilt? And she looked and took one look at me and said, we don't have kilts that big.
Just as well. Perish the thought. Pepe Pearson, who could probably run in a kilt, picks up 4 yards right there. Tackled by Jamal Brooks.
It is an interesting tradition over here. You do see all the workers in kilts, and it is something that, you know, we said, boy, I'd look kind of silly in a kilt, but over here you fit right in.
If everybody's wearing them, yeah.
Right, except for, I don't know how good my legs would look sticking out there, but
no.
You know what? I don't think anybody would notice.
I don't want to find out either, Dale, nothing personal. Second down, play action, Stambar, pressured by Jabbar Threet, gets rid of it, and it's going to be picked off, and should have been picked off by Reggie Hunt. Awful throw from Stambar.
Well, there's obviously a mix-up on the route. Stambar throwing the ball way downfield. But this happened to Scotland last week. Reggie Hunt there had a chance to make the interception. There's nobody around him. You catch this ball, you get momentum on your side. You bring it back to midfield. All of a sudden, your offense has a short field to work with, and you get momentum on your side.
I guess the difference between these two teams is they both struggle offensively. The Fire's defense has come up with those kind of plays.
Exactly, and they've brought them back for touchdowns.
Third down, Stambar will throw again. He gets hit and nailed. down he goes. London Dunlap, and the ball has got into the hands of Jabbar Threets, who could be going in. Now, what are they ruling?
A touchdown, Scotland.
It's been given. Just as we said, the defense hasn't been coming up with the plays. There we go.
Well, I actually think they might have heard us, because if my man Reggie Hunt catches the ball down here, they don't score a touchdown.
He's had quite a season, Jabbar Threets. That puts the icing on it. A 29-yard fumble return. And Rob
72,
Hart,
72!
Closing in a 100 consecutive PATs, will attempt to give the Scottish Claymores a seven-point advantage.
Done. We're done!
And he does. So defense to the four, Dale.
You're going to see the pressure's going to come right in through here. You're going to see Pepe Pearson miss his block. Ball comes loose. And anytime you have pressure up the middle, it spells bad things for your offense. Nice run. What you need to do is hang on that ball until you cross the goal line, because that was too close.
That was very, very borderline.
A touchback.
But no instant replay in this league, which means Jabbar Threets and his 29-yard run stand up. The man allocated here from the Kansas City Chiefs.
So you sit down and you watch film. You watch film all week and you say, you know what, it's going to be a low-scoring game. The Rhein defense is going to have to come out. They're going to probably score some points on defense. Instead, Scotland does.
Pete Kaharchek, we talked to him yesterday. You could tell he was really concerned about this offense of his. And they brought in Jim Arianes, the backup quarterback. They brought him back last week. He didn't play last week. You get the feeling he's going to see some playing time sooner rather than later today.
It's talking to Coach Kaharchek yesterday. He definitely sounded like he's going to get Jim in there. He knows about Jim. He knows Jim's played in big games. And to tell you the truth, the Scotland coaches thought they'd see Jim early in this game and for a long time.
Holloman kicks it off. It's a shallow one that is fielded by Jordan Younger. And Younger stays on his feet. And the ball is loose again. And who's got that? Scotland!
And so the team that is plus 10, leads the league in turnover ratio, has now given the ball up two consecutive plays.
Steve Fontana came up with it, and Pete Kuharchek can barely believe it.
It's just a simple kickoff return right up into the middle. What Scotland does here good is they get in there, they strip the ball. Two guys hold him up, the other guy comes in, strips the ball. Scotland ball with a short field to go.
Well, Pete Kuharchek knows his team's got to win this. Two big plays against the Rhein Fire, back to back. We've had defense, we've had special teams. Will we now have offense? And we've got all sorts of stuff going on over there. Daniel Greer certainly jumped and was immediately pointing to the offensive line.
Ball start, number 67 offense,
and that's
5-yard penalty, first down.
Jay Humphrey, the left tackle.
And the reason Jay Humphrey jumped offside, you heard the quarterback Clint Stoerner yelling out, smoke, smoke. What he's doing was audibly. When you audible, you change the snap count. The left tackle got an early jump, Jay Humphrey there did.
Hey, you're back here.
He was looking to go deep. He thought Rhein was coming into blitz.
Said Hunt.
So they've dug themselves another little offensive hole. First and 15 now. Stoerner will throw. Straight over the middle to a wide open James Whalen. And Whalen bouncing off tackles. Down to the 10-yard line. Tackled eventually by Scott Zimmerman. 25 yards on the completion.
James Whalen, obviously Clint Stoerner's favorite target. You're going to see him right here in the middle of your screen. What he does great is running after the catch. He keeps the legs going, Lee keeps his legs churning. He's not content just to catch the ball and go down. He gains an extra 10 to 15 yards after the catch, which is very important.
But they're now in the red zone. It's been the graveyard of the Scottish Claymores this season.
93 hits!
They'll go on the ground. Anthony Gray gets nothing. And it'll be second and 10 from the 10-yard line.
And Nick, the reason it's been the graveyard for Scotland is
they cannot run the ball.
When you're inside the 20-yard line, you have got to be able to run the ball. You see right here, last in the NFL Europe League. You have to run the ball inside the 20-yard line. The coaches know it, the players know it. They haven't been able to do it yet.
Couper wide left, Hall in the slot to the right. Whalen is the motion man, Gray in the backfield. On second down, and they're looking for Scott Couper. Touchdown, Scotland!
It's the one they all wanted. I think even you got excited, Dale.
I tell you what, you can see it open up. What a pass by Clint Stoerner. And a picture-perfect catch by Scott Couper.
And that gives him his 1,000 yards and his 10th career touchdown in one play. And there's even defensive guys patting him on the back.
Okay, we're done.
Rahar tacks on the extra point. Scotland 14 points up. You know it's special when you've got defensive guys slapping you on the back.
Everybody on that sideline is absolutely ecstatic for Scott Couper. He needed 8 yards for 1,000. He got 9 yards. He got the touchdown.
And it's just been announced officially to the crowd. Place is going crazy.
If Coach Dahlquist could have drawn up a better scenario, I don't think he could have on a play like that.
Steve McCusker, the Glaswegian, who's the national coach here, offering his congratulations. That meant a lot on his last game, didn't it?
The way Scotland set this up, you're going to see James Whalen go in motion right here. And right out here, Cooper's going to get one-on-one coverage. Coach Dahlquist said, when we send James into motion, it gives Rhein the opportunity to go one-on-one on the outside. Clint Stoerner fit it right in there. Picture-perfect catch by Scott Couper.
So 14 points. And the Fire in danger of falling apart here. Younger fields at the four. It's his fumble that set up that last touchdown, and he is clobbered again. The ball's out again. And who's got it this time? Vaughn Saunders with the collision. I think it looks like they may have hung on to that. But Jordan Younger, his heart must be in his mouth.
First down.
What can you say? Turnovers tell the tale of everybody's season.
And the sideline congratulations continue. Oh, this means so much.
I was kind of hoping to see Scott's touchdown dance that we saw on tape.
No, he's given that up. That was the worst one ever 4 years ago. But you can see the joy in his face. First down, on the ground, nothing. Maybe the loss of a yard there. A very fired up defensive front now from Scotland. Pepe Pearson with nothing.
You can sense it. You can sit here and sense it.
And those numbers, 1,000 yards, 10 touchdowns, 67 games, more than anybody else. All he needs now is the 100 receptions.
Right there, all national player records.
And you kind of came into this week not knowing too much about Scott Couper, and you kind of come out of it rather differently, I think.
Oh, definitely.
Second down, Stambaugh looking to get something going, and he's clobbered and loses the football again. And it was recovered by the Fire. Pete Kuharczyk spits in disgust.
And the thing that Rhein has struggled with all year is Stambaugh has got to make a decision. They go and they blitz Keith Miller, but he has good protection right now. Pulls the ball down. Lickinger doesn't even know that he's got the quarterback in his hand. But Stambaugh's got to get rid of that ball a little bit sooner to avoid a sack.
Quick thinking from LaShawn Daniels, and Pete Kuharczyk knows that
turnovers will kill you.
His team plus 10 coming into this game, but in trouble here, and Stanbar's in trouble again and nowhere to go.
And the wheels are coming off this Rhein Fire offense right now.
Nick, again, they try and run a screen on third and 12. Scotland has more guys over there ready to catch the screen pass than Rhein does. You can see the frustration there on Joe Clark's face. Can't get anything going offensively. And anytime you get down 14 points, that seems to be the turning point for an offensive coordinator. Your game plan goes out the window.
I wonder if we'll see Jim Arianis next series for the Fire.
Williams again, they came after him again. And what can Hall do? He fields at the 40, he's past the first man, and he's got space in front of him. And Hall's into Fire territory and still on his feet. Another massive special teams play for the Claymores.
Steve Gleeson eventually on the stop.
But I'm sure these fans are thinking, if only the Claymores were playing like this 3 or 4 weeks ago.
Dante Hall has been a one-man highlight film for Scotland. He does it all. He catches punts, he catches kickoffs, he catches the ball. They try and get him the ball a number of times during the game because he is their one playmaker who can go and make people miss. And again, they have the ball down on the 20-yard line. You're going to score points when you get down there. And to me, this looks like an entirely different Scotland football team than we saw last week.
Jermaine Smith shaken up on the play. He's missed a few weeks already with a shoulder injury. That looks like his wrist. Allocated here from the Seahawks. Started out the season with Amsterdam, then came here in a trade. On the other sideline, we saw John Blick go off with that knee injury. We're hearing he's out for the game. And Smith is being taken straight into the locker room for Scotland as well.
So here's the Claymores offense with terrific field position once more.
Gray gets the carry, not much. Three, and that's it. And surely the Rhein Fire have got to come up with a defensive stand in a hurry.
They do need to come up with a defensive stand right here, because again, you get down to this Scotland defense with that defensive secondary, with that defensive line that can put pressure on your quarterback, especially when they know you're going to throw the ball, it's going to be a long road to home.
The medical staff going to work on Jermaine Smith. Second down, Whalen is the motion man. Play action, they swing it to Dante Hall. Hall tries to cut inside, nothing doing. Sean Mallard coming up and making the stop.
And that was a nice play by Mallard. They try to get the ball out to Dante Hall quickly, give him a little bit of space, and he can make you miss. Sean Mallard came up and made a nice play to keep him to no game.
That'll take us to the end of the quarter. Jermaine Smith continuing to look very shaken up in that Scotland locker room. The medical staff looking on. So, an eventful first quarter here at Hampden Park. All Scotland, they lead it 14-0. Welcome back to Hampden Park in Glasgow. Nick Halling with Dale Hallestrea. Season finale for the Scottish Claymores. And they've started it in style, Dale. 14 points, 7 from the offense, 7 from the defense.
Again, it's somewhere, you know, I think I know a little bit about football, but you sit down and say, hey, Rhein's going to come out. They're going to be fired up. They got a World Bowl berth to win. And Scotland's a team that comes out. Looks like they're going to the World Bowl.
Third down and long. Start of the second quarter. The Claymores looking to build on this lead. Stoerner with a lot of time, and it's tipped. And almost picked off, almost into the hands of Scott Zimmerman. Mark Word applied the pressure. It all means that Rob Hart, the barefoot Englishman from Southampton, will attempt a three-point field goal.
Yeah, what? 72.
37 yards from where they've spotted that. Terrific, terrific season Hart's had. 14 consecutive field goals, tied the NFL Europe record.
There we go, man.
Last week, that one's on its way. It's looking good. And we have a 17-point lead for the Scottish Claymores. Time for a quick timeout. Want to have a shot at defending their World Bowl title. They really need to win this one. Phil Stanbar on the left has had a nightmare first quarter. You wonder if Jim Arianis, who's only been with the team just over a week, might get his shot. Pete Kuharchek just having a word there with Arianis. And Arianis has won a World Bowl with the Fire before. You just think there's a change in the air here. It does seem that way. And the Scotland coaches know that, hey, if Rhein thinks they're going to go ahead and win the World Bowl, they think Jim Arianes is the guy that's going to do it for them.
Holland's kick. And this time it's picked up by Dwight Carter. After a couple of fumbles before, and Carter's looking to turn the corner, and Eric Whitfield drags him down at the 25-yard line. And Jim Arianes comes on. The Fire, of course, know that if they were to win today, and the Berlin would lose in Amsterdam tomorrow, they would almost certainly claim the World Bowl. But it's so complicated, Dale, because if the Rhein Fire win today, that doesn't mean anything. They could actually lose and still qualify for the World Bowl. It's a strange set of circumstances.
But with the tie-breaking procedures that are in place, total offensive, defensive rankings, and head-to-head, and coin flips, and all that, the thing you want to do is you want to come out and win today.
Arianes was the World Bowl MVP 3 years ago. It was his only start of the season as well. Came in for the injured Mike Quinn, and he'll go on the ground first of all, and Pepe Pearson gets 4 yards there. The following year, he was backing up Mike Cherry, and they made a switch with 4 games of the season left. Again, the offense was struggling, and Arianes just ripped up the league for those last 4 games as well. So he's a bit of a cult hero in Dusseldorf.
Well, I tell you what, he just comes in and gets the job done. You watch him throw balls in warm-ups. They're not real pretty balls, but somehow he moves the offense, which is what they need right now.
Second down and 6. They certainly need something to fire. Back on the ground again. Pepe Pearson is chopped down by Reggie Hunt. Came blasting through. And Pearson is finally going tough here.
Scotland almost seems to be in the Rhein Fire huddle. What they do is they play games. They walk their safeties up. They bring them back. Reggie Hunt is the guy who's going to come up. You see him right here. He starts out deep, then he comes up. He actually is your fifth linebacker. He comes up and he fills the gap that if he was playing coverage, Pepe Pearson would have had a nice hole to run through.
We haven't seen Arianes throw yet. Will we hear on third and a long 3? Yes. And it's almost complete to Joe Perez, the former Claymore who couldn't bring it in. No flags, 3 and out for Jim Arianes. Well, worth making the point that Eddie Hardaway, the Fire's leading receiver, is out of this game with a shoulder problem. But the Fire offensively have done nothing so far. Williams has been the busiest player on the team. Kicks to Hall. Good kick, but Hall has got past the first tackler again. And the flag comes in the Claymores backfield as Hall is down at the 42-yard line by Ronnie Nix. But we'll have to check out that flag. And that will push it back. Has gone right for the Rhein Fire so far, as we just hear from
Peter. During the return, illegal block in the back above the waist. Number 38, receiving team. 10-yard penalty, first down.
That's Renard Cox.
And Nick, this week I ran into an old friend of mine, the field judge, number 133 here. Steve Freeman was actually a teammate of mine in Buffalo back in 1985.
How come he looks so young?
Well, I tell you what, the thing is, he was in his 12th year. I was a rookie. We ran into each other at the airport, talked a little bit, found out that he has a son who is playing football, 24, 25 years old, and he's going to be a grandpa. I played with him.
What's his secret then?
Well, I don't know.
How old is he, 50? I mean, he looks about 35.
Yeah, he's 48 years old, and he looks younger than I do.
I hate him. I really hate him.
He's in great shape.
He is. That's
you see him at the hotel every morning. He's already coming back from a workout.
Well, it's the Rhein Fire defense is getting a workout right now. Trying to stop this Scotland offense. Anthony Gray plows his way for 8 more yards. Clarence LeBlanc on the tackle. And it's defense that's been winning games for the Rhein Fire. They need a big play here.
Well, they definitely do. But what you're going to see is this Scotland offense, the offensive line has just gained confidence with each point that's been scored. They run a little G scheme there. You're going to see Kendall Mack come out, make a nice block. Anthony Gray's running with a lot of confidence right now.
Second down on a couple. Dante Hall, the motion man. Back on the ground. And an attempt to reverse his field. And Anthony Gray was way too ambitious there and lost 5 yards. Julian Duncan with the easy tackle. And Gray tried to be a superstar.
Anytime I see a running back reverse direction and start running backwards, I just cringe. Because in this league and in the NFL, the defensive players are too fast. You can't beat them to the sideline.
Gus Ornstein gets the second quarter for the Scottish Claymores. That was a planned switch. A man here from the Kansas City Chiefs, who spent much of the season on the bench, got an opportunity last week in Barcelona. That was an ugly game.
And we got flags everywhere.
The ball was dead and down, so Kelly Gregg's advance will not count. Again, we have the officials to clear it all up for us.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 67, offense, 5 yard penalty, still third down.
Jay Humphrey's number called once again.
And that's the second time that that's happened to Jay. Now what happens, though, you get a new quarterback in there, you have a new cadence, you have a new rhythm. People don't understand that it is a big deal to your offensive lineman to get into a rhythm with your quarterback.
Third downs have been virtually non-existent so far, and this one's going to be as well. Vaughn Sanders gets five, but nowhere near the first down. Bastian Lano, the fearsome-looking German defensive end on the stop, and three and out for Gus Ornstein.
And I think that what happens there is Coach Dahlquist sees a 17-0 lead. He's by nature conservative. So he's going to say, my defense is playing real well right now. We'll run a conservative play, punt the ball downfield, and play good, solid defense.
Costello on to kick to Jordan Younger. And the kick is on his way. It's another beauty from Costello, and Younger is backed up all the way to his 23. And he's coughed up a couple of kickoff returns. But this time he's going to be just pushed out of bounds. A real collision on the far sideline, and a flag comes in. London Dunlap was involved in that. We'll have to check out that flag. There were some bodies flying around on that far sideline as Younger went out of bounds. And after that sizzling start from the Claymores, the second quarter's just gone off the boil a little bit. A lot of flags. A couple of three and outs. And that, a personal foul against the Rhein Fire. We'll push this thing back 15 yards.
Right there.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 35 on the receiving team. 15-yard penalty, first down.
Clarence LeBlanc will be in Pete Garchick's doghouse for this.
What I like to see here, Nick, is last week against Barcelona, they had a punt return on them for a touchdown. I know they worked on their lanes. You're going to see London Dunlap right there. Last week, him and Casey Tisdale got sucked into the middle of the field. Trevor Inslee took it around the left side for about an 80-yard touchdown. Today, they stayed in their lane.
So the ball back to the 24-yard line of Pete Kuharczyk's World Bowl dream, hanging by. First down. They put Stoerner back in.
We're done! We're done!
But the result was pretty much the same. Bray Woodard congratulates Sahomi this time. Woodard, the defensive coordinator, who's done a fine job. But interesting that they brought Stoerner back.
Well, it is interesting, but to go back to the Scotland defense, talking to Coach Woodard before the game, he said that, hey, he treated this week like a bowl week. He said the guys had distractions, they had a pack, they had to get their pre-exit physicals, a bunch of things had to go on before they played this game. And so what ended up happening was he said,
come on, man, go one game. You a bad man, ain't you? Come on, ain't no one, D. Come on, man, don't act like that, man.
A little bit of distension in the ranks.
Well, to finish my thought, the thing about the defense is it seems like the more simple things are, the more you can just lay your ears back and come get the quarterback and cover the guy, which gives you a better chance to be successful.
Right.
obviously, offensively, you don't like to hear two players going at each other like that. That does happen, and it happens quite a bit. This is the only league where you can actually listen to it.
Check Jet 3, Pedro, on one. Yeah.
The Jet is the pass protection. 5-7 step drop for Stoerner. He's going to be looking downfield.
Wide, 98,
and Hall, the speed man, is wide to the right. Stoerner is going for Whalen, and Whalen actually puts one down, which doesn't happen too often.
You don't see that happen too often. I think Whalen was looking again to run after the catch. The key is you have to catch it, then you run.
Right there. Now, between right, wide, 20, big.
Y 20 dig on one.
Anytime you hear a Y and a dig and things like that, the Y doesn't refer to any running play whatsoever. So look, the Y is Whalen. Look for Whalen to be digging somewhere.
Third down and 10. We have flags. That one is blown dead. I wonder if we're going to hear a Scottish offensive lineman's number called again.
I think you're going to have a false start on the Scotland offensive line once again.
Prior to the snap, false start, number 87, offense, 5-yard penalty, still
James Whalen
down.
Well, he drops one, he gets a flag.
Well, maybe he set it up for him to make a big play here or something.
Yeah.
Like Phil Jackson said, Kobe Bryant back in high school would set things up to have ropes at the end. Again, I just have a feeling he was a split second early on the ball. I think that has to do with the different quarterbacks, and each quarterback has his own
game.
Hall is wide right, Cooper to the left. Whalen is in the slot.
Wide, 98, hut!
Third and a bunch. Deep drop. And it's going to be very difficult to make a first down from there, and nothing doing. Corey Harris on the stop. And they've got Randy Palmer, but only for 5 yards.
And again, I think Scotland's content with that right now. They're content to play this type of ball game. Now pump the ball downfield and play defense. Rhein has shown no signs of being able to move the ball on the Claymores defense.
Not seen much offense in this second quarter, have we? Actually, we didn't see too much in the first. We expected a defense-dominated game. That's what we're getting.
Watch out!
Punter's working really well. And Younger has got some space. Vaughan Sanders chops him down, but again, he's got it into Scotland territory. 2:37 left. We have flags. We've had a lot of flags.
There have been a lot of flags. Usually you see that early in the season. By the end of the season, the flags have been cut down.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 88. The penalty will be declined. First down.
Steve Fontana, the guilty man. You get the sense, Dale, that if the Fire want to make a game of this, they've got to put a drive together right here.
They do, and that's what they're looking to Jim Arianas for right now, is to somehow get points on the board. As a lot of coaches have said, the first points are always the hardest. Once you get the first points on the scoreboard, you gain a little bit of confidence. They need to do that here in the last 2.5 minutes.
Look at that yardage output. I mean, Scotland's nothing to brag about. Rhein Fire might as well not be here. First down at Scotland's 45. The noise level just went up. And that one's batted down by Casey Tisdale. Second and 10.
I got it, Pete.
Again, the thing I keep going back to is this Scotland defense plays a different scheme than any other defense that Rhein has gone against. They play with 3 down linemen and they play with 4 linebackers. With that, you can bring any combination of linebackers, 4 from a side. The offensive line doesn't know where they're coming from.
On second down. The Fire's offensive problems continue. That's Arianas to get something going here and he can't. It's overthrown. Bernard Cox was matching his man, Andre Cooper, step for step.
On the post.
And what I like there is I like to see when the cornerback sees the receiver, Andre Cooper, turn around and look for the ball. You see Bernard Cox turn around and look for the ball.
And
That takes us to the 2-minute warning, and the Fire will face a 3rd and 10 when we return. They also face a 17-point deficit. Winning on the road has been a big problem for teams this season, and we arrived at the Fire team hotel yesterday at exactly the same time as the Fire players arrived. Pete Kaharchek said it was an 8-hour journey, and he looked like he'd been 12 rounds of Mike Tyson, didn't he?
Oh, I tell you what, he looked absolutely worn out. And you look down here at the bottom, 0-5. Teams here in NFL Europe have really struggled on the road. The only team that has a winning record, the Barcelona Dragons, and that has to do with having a little bit more talent than the other teams.
Pete probably still feels like he's been a few rounds with Mike Tyson. Why Scotland's been pounding him. On the gun. Arianis is hit as he throws. It's incomplete. Casey Tisdale and Dusty Renfro just clobbered Arianis. And substitute teaching suddenly has a bit of an appeal to it, doesn't it?
I mean, you sit here and watch again. The 3-4 defense causes problems. Casey Tisdale coming off the left side is completely unblocked. You don't set up a protection to let a linebacker come and hit your quarterback right in the face. But with the short practice week, all the distractions, sometimes you're going to have an assignment mistake.
So once again, Gordon Williams from the Giants. He gets it away, looking for the angle. And Hall fields at the 12 and then goes backwards and will end up with minus yardage on that return. Minute 45 left in the first half here. It all really happened at the same time. We had the big play on defense, then the big play on special teams, then the touchdown pass to Scott Couper, and on either side of that, not really a lot so far.
No, it all came in a big hurry there, and now the teams have settled down. What's going to be interesting to see here is Coach Dalquist and his personality going to come through. Is he going to play it conservatively, or is he going to try and get some more points here before halftime?
Stay with me.
Well, by nature, Dahlquist is very conservative.
What
do you think? Another touchdown. Really would put a knife through the heart of the Rhein Fire. On the ground they go. Anthony Gray bouncing around and starting to build up ahead of steam and picking up 8 yards. Well, we talk about turnovers. They had a defensive turnover and a special teams turnover, the Rhein Fire today. Pete Kaharchek always says you live and die by turnovers. They were plus 10 coming into this game. That's possibly why they're losing today.
Oh, definitely. And if they wouldn't be plus 10, their record would probably be about 2-8 this year. They are in the World Bowl hunt because they are plus 10 turnover mark.
Stoerner with second and short, and he'll convert the first down. And a bit of shake and bake.
Here we go, Bob.
Picks up an extra couple of yards to the 30. Mike Sands, the outside linebacker, on the stop.
It looks like Scotland's going to try and score some points. They look like a completely different offense than they did last week. And Clint Stoerner's confidence is growing with every play.
But they're inside the final minute. Clock management has sometimes been a problem this year. Stoerner goes straight down the middle for Whalen, who hangs on and almost got past Scott Zimmerman. If Zimmerman didn't hang on, Whalen was gone.
Whalen looked like Mike Ditka there, running through and over people. And the thing is, Clint Stoerner, the only person that he would throw the ball, you're going to see James Whalen right here run down the field. The only person that Clint would throw the ball to into double coverage is James Whalen, because he said Whalen's either going to catch the ball or going to knock it down. No bad things happen when the ball is thrown to James Whalen. Again, we talked about it earlier, the run after the catch. He did a nice job there, gaining a few extra yards. He's going for the reception title here in NFL Europe, and he's off to a great start here in the first half.
5 catches. He led that reception race by 3 from Barcelona's Trevor Inslee. Doing his cause no harm at all here, James Whalen. He's on course for a Claymores single season record, a tight end record. So they're up by 17. Can they punch some more points in here? Can the Fire make a stand defensively? Stoerner's going end zone, Whalen, and he drops it. It's incomplete.
Oh, no.
Whalen's insisting he got it. The officials immediately ruled otherwise, and they were right there to see it.
It was the exact same play, only the other side. Whalen runs a great route, gets open, and drops the ball. He's done that twice now. You usually don't see him do that, I think he got a little bit excited about how open he was. He's used to getting hit as soon as he catches the ball. Stoerner throws a great ball over the linebacker and between the defensive backs.
Great hit from D. Cooper,
by the way. You've got to make this catch. D. Cooper comes over and punches the ball out with his helmet. Looks like before Whalen gets his second foot down.
Timeout, nice call. Scotland, third and final team timeout. That will be a 30-second timeout.
We're going to do a double pass. All right, we're in Raptor. Triple right, over gun. Double pass left, green right to the quarterback.
Unbelievable!
Then be ready to kill it.
I tell you what, Coach Dahlquist told us about this play coming in right here.
Yeah, we're going to spike it here. Listen up. Stay with me. We got triple right, over, double pass left, screen right to the quarterback. On one, ready?
Gun,
yeah.
The ball's going to start in Clint Stoerner's hands, and hopefully it's going to end up in Clint Stoerner's hands. Coach Dahlquist said the play looked horrible all week during practice. He's going to call it one time.
Let's see what happens. There's the swing for Whalen. There it is. They've got it back, and he's got blockers in front of him. It might have looked horrible in practice, it didn't in reality.
And when he told me that, I said, you know what, I don't know how many times you practice a trick play in practice and it doesn't work, and it works in the game, and it's also vice versa. Clint Stoerner, who's got a lot of athletic ability, you put the ball in his hands. The neat thing about this is that the roles were reversed. James Whalen completing a pass to Clint Stoerner.
Whalen got a hit for his pains as well.
And you see Stoerner sit there and play stupid for a little bit. A very nice job of executing the play that you just put in earlier in the week.
First down and 10. They think end zone. Lonnie Mitchell. Can he get out of bounds? Yes, he did. No. Yes, they have stopped the clock. Or have they? Deshaun Mallard on the stop. They've ruled that he stayed in bounds. So they've got to get on with it here. I'm not sure that they realize. Yes, they do. The clock down to 6, and Stoerner just spikes it.
Hey! I tell you what, I know exactly what Clint's saying right now. He's saying the guy got out of bounds.
And that's what it looked like to me.
It certainly did, but the referee thinks that if the guy could have been tackled in the field of play, he's going to keep the clock going.
72!
It means Rob Hart's back out there. This will be 22 yards. Should be a chip shot for the barefoot foot.
Okay.
Barefoot man. There it is. And the last act of the first half sees the Scottish Claymores tack on 3 more points to take a 20-point advantage into the locker room at halftime. And for the Fire, a team that needed to win on the road to keep their World Bowl hopes alive, they've been dead flat. Pete Kuharczyk with a lot of work to do. We're going to take a short break. Back in a moment. I don't know what he said in the locker room at halftime, but I'm just kind of glad I wasn't in there to hear it.
I have a feeling it wasn't anything pleasant. The bottom line is you got 30 minutes of football. Jim Arianes has led comebacks before. He's a guy who can get the job done, but they have to score. And against this Scotland defense, as good as it's playing, seemingly blitzing from everywhere, they've really shut down the Rhein offense. And you take a look, you have... Last week and this week, their defense has played outstanding.
Dante Hall is going to have to drop to a knee there, so Stoerner will take over from his own 20-yard line. But yeah, you're quite right. I mean, the pass defense of the Scottish Claymores, I mean, they completed one pass, I believe, all game long, the Rhein Fire.
It seems like the Scottish Claymores defense has been in the backfield the entire game. What I find interesting here, looking at the Claymores offense coming on the field, is that Clint Stoerner came in midway through the second quarter. We had talked about Gus Ornstein going to come in, he's going to get the second quarter, but I think Coach Dahlquist said, hey, I want to win this ball game.
And those numbers from Stoerner, it's been a very assured performance from him. Touchdown to Cooper.
Wait, 98!
Now, what kind of drive can they come out with here? A quick swing pass to Lonnie Mitchell, and Mitchell falls forward to the 29, Deshaun Mallard on the
stop. And if the Rhein Fire, who've lived on their defense all season long, are going to make a game of this, they've got to make a defensive stand here. Any more points, you think it's going to be beyond them.
Well, and the defensive backfield is where it's going to come from. The defensive line putting pressure on the quarterback, stopping the run, and then Mallard and Harris and Couper and Gleason, and those guys have to come up with a big play.
All those names you mentioned, we've not called their numbers once. Second down.
We're done.
Stoerner will pull his way forward. From where that's been spotted, they will move the chains. Well, probably a bit unfair to ask you to speculate on this, Dale, because you're a teammate, but how do you think this fella and James Whalen, also your teammate, are going to fare when they get back to Dallas's training camp?
Well, I tell you what, I have absolutely no doubt that James Whalen's going to come in.
Wing right,
he's going to have a lot of success over. They like the way that he moves around, the way he moves without the ball, and he gets open. That's the bottom line. It doesn't matter anything else. He gets open, he catches the ball.
Wide 98 hits.
First down, Stoerner drops the throw. Pump fake, got a wide open Dante Hall, and Hall's got a lot of room in front of him. And Hall is in a foot race now to the 20, gets a block down inside the 15 and still on his feet. A huge play from the Scottish Claymores offense. And the Fire are struggling on offense, but now their defense is breaking too.
Well, I think what's happening now is the defensive backs are trying to make something happen. So what ends up happening is the defensive backs are going for interception. They're jumping routes, things like that. What it does is it allows for the Claymores offense to come up with big plays, something that they have not done. Dante Hall has been a big part of this offensive explosion.
All the way down to the 11-yard line.
188, green smoke seven, dragon, green smoke seven, hut!
Pass down, the swing pass is to Lonnie Mitchell.
Here we go,
he
son.
Can't get it, Corey Harris was there to break it up.
Again, you heard Clint calling out, smoke seven, smoke seven. That means that he feels there's going to be a safety blitz. He's going to have one-on-one coverage outside, and he's going to try and get the ball downfield. When you're inside the 20-yard line, though, it kind of limits your options because the end zone really acts as another defender.
Said, hut, got him, pick.
Back in the red zone again.
Wide, 98, hut.
Second down, Stoerner straight down the middle. James Whalen, touchdown, Scotland. As simple as that. They're saving their best till last. An 80-yard drive, the big play that Dante Hall set it up. Whalen with his first touchdown of this ball game, his third of the season. Rob Hart with the extra point. That's good. Scotland are good. 27-0. Rhein Fire all but extinguished. The Claymores over the Fire.
Whalen here in the slot. What he does is he just runs a quick post. Takimoto's going to try and cover him one-on-one. Whalen is a little bit too shifty, a little bit too nifty. And also, Clint Stoerner throws a very nice ball out in front where only Whalen's going to catch the ball. Anytime Clint Stoerner sees James Whalen one-on-one with a linebacker, that's where he's going with the ball.
And that linebacker was Masaki Takimoto as well, the Japanese linebacker. And that really,
you see how he stand?
Twist the knife. As far as the Rhein Fire are concerned, exactly what they did not want. They needed a defensive stand. Instead, it was a Scottish big play and another touchdown, and Chad Holliman gets us going. Dwight Carter fields. Carter is just clobbered, and the ball's bouncing around once again. And what's the ruling? It looks like the Fire may have come up with that, but special teams has been a feature here once again this afternoon, and in a day of milestones as we wait for confirmation. The offense
ball
is coming on. Here's another milestone. Rob Hart with his 100th consecutive PAT. Whatever you think of kickers, Dale, I know you guys all hate kickers. 100 in a row is no mean achievement.
100 in a row of doing anything is an achievement. And, you know, different snappers, different holders, all those things that have come into play for him. To make 100 in a row, you have to be good.
And the smiling continues on the Scottish sideline. No smiles on the other sideline, and they bring back Phil Stambaugh, who stumbles, now goes downtown and overthrows his man. He was looking for the speedster, Michael Lewis, who had drawn double coverage, and you just wonder where the Fire are going to get some offense from.
You wonder, with their leading receiver, Eddie Hardaway, sitting the game out because he's so banged up. You wonder where the offense is going to come from. Somebody has to step up and make a play. They were hoping that Mike Lewis was going to be the threat that could get deep downfield. Stambaugh there, hanging on the ball a little bit too long, allowing the safety to get over and get double coverage on Mike down the field.
Second down and 10.
Touch it.
They have 12 men on the field, and Antonio Dingle's trying to get off, but there's no flag. And Stambaugh is almost picked off by Reggie Hunt. There is now the flag. Dingle, the big man, all 300 and whatever pounds of him, was racing to get off the field, and I don't think he made it in time.
I mean,
that's a big man to be running fast.
I tell you what, some of the defensive backs might be able to run off the field and not be seen, but when you're over 300 pounds, there is absolutely no way that you're going to get by all those referees' eyes.
Well, they list Antonio Dingle at 315. Well, what's going on here? Dingle was certainly sprinting off the field.
Ineligible receiver downfield, number 63. The penalty is declined.
That's ridiculous. That's Michael Early. So they don't even get the penalty when they need it, the Rhein Fire. And Dingle is now trying to work out for the U.S. track team.
You're going to see Dingle right here. He obviously miscounted, just like we did. He thought there were 12 men on the field. There were actually only 11, because trust me, a guy that big is going to get caught.
He's back in there, and he's not going anywhere this time. Third down from the gun. Stambaugh feels the heat, goes down, crunched. They blitzed him from both directions. Bryant Shaw got him one way. Dusty Renfro got him the other.
During the first half, it was exclusively 3-4 defense by Scotland. They put pressure on with linebackers. Now they go to a four-man line, and they bring Dusty Renfro as the fifth man. The running back, Pappy Pearson, fails to pick him up again. Another sack.
Part of that is losing John Blick, the right tackle early. Brian Connolly coming in and filling in for him. But it's been total dominance, and Williams has punted very well for the Fire, and Dante Haldo has returned well, and he's got another one into Rhein Fire territory, and he's still on his feet. He's got one man to beat. It's Williams, and he could be gone. There are flags. This may come back, and we have an injured Fire player down on the field as well, who's not moving. Now he is. That's DeMario Brown, and it's all coming back, and Brown looks very shaken up.
There are more things going on this field.
Amazing stuff.
During the return, illegal block in the back, number 96 of the receiving team, 10-yard penalty. First down.
That's big Doug Miller. DeMario Brown is walking off under his own steam. That's good news. And the Scottish Claymores will have the ball when we return.
Dante Hall's exciting run was called back. You can see right here, big Doug Miller. Once again, a big guy. You're not going to hide in the middle of the field. Throws a block right in the back, right in the middle of the field. All referees' eyes are right there. And the thing about it is, it's a block that really wasn't even crucial to the run back.
Didn't release him, did it? So
and the funny thing about it is you see Doug Miller arguing with the referees. He knew he hit him in the middle of the back.
You got to make your point. Meanwhile, it's got very dark here. It's got very overcast. It's getting very overcast for that fellow as well, Joe Clark. He's been consistently productive wherever he's coached. Joe Clark in this league, be it Frankfurt, be it Amsterdam, but here this season with the Rhein Fire, we talked to him yesterday,
yeah.
he just said, I don't know what to do.
Yeah, he seemed a little bit frustrated. You know, you get back to the weather real quick. I've been here for a couple days, Nick, and I hear all about this rain and wind and all that in Scotland. We've enjoyed a couple gorgeous days. Got out to golf a little bit, and it's been beautiful. Joe Clark, though, when he said that, you could tell.
He wishes he was on a golf course right now.
I believe at this particular moment, he does.
Very, very gloomy down here at Hampden Park. The light probably looks all right on the TV screen, but I tell you, it's a little bit gloomy down there.
Wide, 88, hut!
First down with the end-around play action instead. Now they've got it to Anthony Gray. Gray gets a block and spins his way to the 42-yard line. Corey Harris on the stop. There just seems to be a swagger and a confidence about the Claymores in this game
that we haven't seen. Watching film or watching them live last week. They fake the handoff to Dante Hall. The entire Rhein defense has their eye open for Hall because they know he's a big playmaker. And for once, the screen pass does work.
Good for 7 yards. Scott Couper back in the ball game. He's wide right. Corey Allen wide left.
Wide 98.
It's the motion man. Anthony Gray is the man looking to turn the corner. Not much doing there. Back to the line of scrimmage and no further. Zimmerman and Mallard on the stop. If ever a team needed a turnover, it's the Rhein Fire right now.
And if there ever was a defensive team that could get it done, it's the Rhein Fire defense.
Third down. And still three.
99 pitch on one. On ready. X, let me look. X, let me look.
Sounded like you're gonna go 99 pitch.
Hurry up, hurry up.
Means they're gonna pitch to the left side. Bob Saunders around the left end.
That's what they're gonna do. There is Saunders. He's getting
okay,
nothing.
Okay, we're done.
Well short. Galen Hyder, the big defensive tackle, was in the thick of that. Now the punting unit comes on.
I don't know if the stadium people heard the referees. They asked for the lights to be turned on before this last series. It's getting hard to see the field down there.
It really is. There's the lights not on. And it's pretty gloomy down there. I tell you, if this was a cricket match, Dale, bad light would stop play. You probably don't know what on earth I'm talking about. Costello, that thing is just hanging in the air, and a fair catch is called for in the gloom, and a nice job done by Jordan Younger. What height from Costello, and a long field for the Fire to work with. Play action. Stoerner's bought himself some time and bought himself a man. It's James Whalen, and talking of milestones, here's one we missed earlier. James Whalen came into this game needing 5 receptions to become the all-time Scotland receiver, receiving record holder in a season. That, I think, was reception number 8.
You're going to see James Whalen right here, and he's going to end up coming all the way across the field with the rollout to his left. Stoerner buys a little bit of time, allows Whalen to come open, and there's some space out there. Clint completes the pass.
There's confirmation. It's a record-setting season for James Whalen.
Green smoke stick, hut!
First down, Stoerner pump fake, goes long, looks in the direction of Corey Allen. And Allen, has he brought it in? No, they're ruling it out. Great effort from Allen, working Corey Harris, but couldn't get both feet down. Records all over the place today, haven't we? We've got Scott Couper with his touchdown, and Rob Hart with his extra points, and James Whalen with his catches. And for a team with nothing to play for, they've come out to play.
They've come out to play. They've played well.
Don't go to three-step. What do we need to do?
And talking to James Whalen before the game, I said, you know what? The coaches are going to look at this game. They want to see how you do when you're just playing for pride.
Let's go deuce right, draw two, on one, on one. Hurry up.
When you're playing for pride. You're going to see the handoff to Von Sanders right up the middle. It's going to be able to lay a handoff.
The rain falling heavily now here. Von Sanders falling heavily well. We'll lose a yard.
You heard Clint Stoerner there saying we need to hurry up. The play call needs to get in. Over here in NFL Europe, the play clock gives you a little bit less time than in the NFL. Therefore, you got to pick everything up. Scotland's had a little bit of problem with that all year long. Yeah. Haven't seen it too much today.
Lonnie Mitchell's in the slot.
98.
Corey Allen is to the left. Lonnie Mitchell to the right.
bounces out of the hands and it just falls incomplete. Clarence LeBlanc thought he had a piece of that. Didn't quite make it. Somehow that sums up the Rhein Fire's day today. Didn't quite make it.
When things are going your way, you know what? You catch that ball. And you're up and running and they return it for a touchdown. When things aren't going your way, ball's a half yard in front of you.
And now with the rain coming down, a slippery football for Jordan Younger to deal with. Stella gets it away. Younger. Oh, crunch by Roel Bleckman, who got there a split second too early. And a Fire player is down and hurting. And Bleckman, who leads the team, that leads the league in all-time special teams tackles, is going to get a flag for that. But it was only half a step too early. Yeah, well, we've got all sorts of stuff going on down there. And Younger, very shaken.
The rule is you need to give the punt returner ample room to catch the ball. That is defined by 2 to 3 yards for him to catch the ball. Obviously, when you're being blocked, though, when you're being blocked, it's hard to tell and hard to gauge how far you're away. You're just trying to make a play.
Looks like a cut on the throat there for Younger as well. And he is being brought straight off for treatment. No going back to the Fire sidelines. He's coming straight off the field. Boy, when things go wrong for you, what has gone right for the Rhein Fire today?
I can't think of one thing that's gone right for them other than they showed up at the stadium on time, I think.
There is no foul for fair catch interference. The receive, a member of the kicking team was blocked. A member of the receiving team was blocked into a member of the receiving team was blocked into the receiver of the ball. Therefore, there's no foul. It touched the receiver. It has been recovered by Scotland. First down.
Oh, wow. When it goes wrong, it goes wrong. Can you believe this?
You're going to see right here, they're fighting against each other, and the referees decided that he was actually blocked in to the punt returner rather than running into him on his own. And the rule states that if you're blocked into the guy, there's no penalty.
So Roel Blenman's big hit creates another turnover. Wow.
Oh. You can see he got hit right up underneath the face mask, and that's where the gash opened up on his chin.
And that's not funny. I was talking to Roel Blenman before the game. He's like Scott Couper. He's played 7 years in the league. And he said, I'm glad Scott's retiring because I'm coming back for number 8 next year.
Wide 98, hut.
First down. Stoerner with the pump fake over the middle, incomplete. It'll be second down. I'm sure Pete Kuharczyk would take this game ending now if he could.
You just don't sense that Rhein has anything going on. You see the war paint.
Look at all that war paint.
But special teams players always have that little bit of a wild side to them. You got a Bill Bates, you got people like that who did the NFL, paint themselves up, get excited.
Oh, Roel does that if you see him in the street, though.
Oh, does he?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Nut!
Second down. Stoerner gets past one guy. Now thinks end zone. Can't quite find Corey Allen. It's going to be third down.
Stoerner showing a little bit of his athletic ability here again. They run the naked again. And you're going to see there's going to be a little bit of pressure put on him by Terrell Jerniak. Pump fakes him almost like a basketball player, escapes around the right end, and then smartly throws the ball where only one of his guys, Corey Allen, could catch the ball.
Gerald Williams goes wide right. Corey Allen to the left. Couper is the slot receiver, and from the shotgun on 3rd and 10. Stoerner has Whalen yet again, and Whalen inside the 10. First down, Mike Sands on the stop. But they will move the chains once more.
Clint Stoerner, one of the tougher quarterbacks that I've ever been around. He's in the shotgun. What he does is he hangs on to that ball to the very last second. Takes a hit for the team, gets steamrolled, completes the pass and gets the first down, though. And believe me, his teammates respond to that and respect that immensely.
Scotland winning the first down battle. I believe that was the first third down conversion of the day as well. First and goal from the seven. Scotland looking to pour it on.
Wide 98 hit.
Play action, Stoerner's in trouble. Somehow gets out of it and then gets hit. Masaki Tokimoto, the Japanese linebacker, will get the credit for that sack. Meanwhile, we have an injured player down on the field for the Scottish Claymores as well. Looks like one of those, could be John Jacobs. So they are slowly but surely attending to Jacobs.
Well, the thing about it is Scotland's had such a great day. Everything's gone their way. They've done a wonderful job on offense, on defense, on special teams. You'd hate to see an injury mar a game like this for them. And really to put this guy's career in jeopardy when he's played 10 games. He's done a nice job for Scotland. He's moved around a little bit. He wants to give himself a chance to go play in the NFL next year.
So Jacobs continues to get treatment, and while he does, we will take a short break. Well, just a few moments ago, John Jacobs was taken away, but got a terrific ovation and just was there, able to acknowledge it as well. And what a horrible way for a season to end.
You hate to see anybody come off on a car. Let's just hope that it's precautionary and that he does have a sprain.
Wide 98!
Scott Cooper's in the ball game. Wonder if they'll look for him again in the red zone.
Wide 98! Hut.
Second down. Stoerner is looking in the direction of Cooper. And it bounced off Deshaun Mallard's helmet and a flag came in. Stoerner had Cooper all the way, but so too did Mallard. And let's see what that flag's all about. It goes against the fire.
Ball will be placed on the first 1 yard line. First down.
First and goal at the one.
Clint Stoerner told us yesterday, he said, hey, if I have a choice, I'm going to look for the Scott Couper matchup because I know how important this game is to him. He said, I'll even go so far as to try and force a ball in there to give him a chance to make a catch. Clint Stoerner said, I'm going one place on this play, and that's Scott Couper.
Let's go. Don't think they'll be going to Scott Couper on this play. The power formation, and Vaughn Sanders dives his way in for the touchdown. Now we have flags because the Rhein Fire are doing some pushing and shoving. I think it was mainly them. You can understand the frustration those guys must be feeling. They have been humiliated this afternoon.
How about this red zone offense of the Scottish Claymores? They're going to get that percentage all the way up. They're going to end up being respectable when all year they struggle.
Morelli.
After the play, personal foul, number 33 on the defense, unnecessary roughness. The touchdown is good, the penalty will be enforced on the kickoff.
That is 33 on the offense, Vaughn Sanders, the man who scored the touchdown. And look at that, the Rhein Fire just falling apart in front of us here, Dale. Rob Hart, the extra point centurion. He hasn't worked so hard all season.
Okay, we're done.
There's another one.
Tell you what, the inside of that bare foot might start to get a little bit raw having to kick as many times as he has today.
That's six. That's four extra points and two field goals for Rob Hart. And it's going to be a horrible journey back to Dusseldorf for these fellas.
I don't know why we sit down and watch film and try and analyze these games and sit down and say, hey, who's going to score and who's not and what's the game going to be like? And with all our expert analysis.
Yeah. The one thing we both said, not many points, lots of defense.
Yes, and low scoring.
The Rhein Fire defensively so strong all year long, which is a tribute to Pete Kuharczyk and his defensive acumen, but this time the defense has just given up.
You just get down here, they've had so much confidence over here on the left side of the offensive line. they hand the ball off to Vaughn Sanders, and he just sticks his head down and runs behind his left guard, left tackle, Humphrey and Mack for a touchdown. It's amazing what happens when you can get on a little bit of a roll as an offensive football team. Everybody feels good, and that's what you're seeing down there today.
You just sense with this Fire defense that they've carried the load for so long, this was just a game too far for them.
Right, and that's kind of what happened to Scotland last week, where the defense can carry you so far, but it gets demoralizing when you can't score points offensively.
Well, of course, no Jordan Younger to handle returns for the Rhein Fire. He, of course, is having a gash in his throat attended to. It's been that kind of day for the Rhein Fire, it really has. Brad Costello with the kick, and it's fielded at the 20-yard line. And Michael Lewis gets it all the way to the 42-yard line. Well, there's two more games tomorrow, of course, and then this issue of the World Bowl will be decided. Later today, Barcelona, who are already going, will round out their regular season at Frankfurt. And then the big one tomorrow in Amsterdam. Berlin go to Amsterdam. A Berlin win now, you sense, with this result here, puts the Thunder in their first ever World Bowl. If Amsterdam were to win that game, the way the tiebreakers work, the Fire could yet get in. I mean, it's a bizarre situation here. But basically, the team with destiny in their own hands is the Berlin Thunder. First down from the gun, Arianis is back in there, and he's completed a pass to Jason Brookins, and Brookins will pick up first down yardage. Keith Miller eventually pushing him out of bounds. A 17-yard pickup, Arianis' first completion of the ball game.
And sometimes, again, you get there, you get an easy completion, things can get going. You're going to see that the Rhein Fire are going to go to their two-man offense. If you look at the standings, though, and Rhein Fire, even though losing today, they can still get to the World Bowl. I don't know if they'd want to go play next week after a day like this.
Well, I tell you, they'll have to do better than this if they do make it to the World Bowl. Arianis from the shotgun. Four wide receivers on first down. There's another completion. J.J. Huggins, the tight end, is crunched by Reggie Hunt. And a three-yard pickup. London Dunlap was in there as well. This has not been the return that Jimmy Arianis would have wanted for himself.
No, it definitely isn't. You know, the interesting thing is he said he hadn't thrown a pass since the second week in April until last Thursday. You knew there was going to be some kind of rust, but I think that they were hoping the magic would come through and overtake that rust. I don't think it has.
Not against this Scotland defense. And that is the end of the third quarter. We have one quarter of play left in the regular season. The Scottish Claymores overwhelming the Rhein Fire. Welcome back to Hampden Park in Glasgow.
I'm hanging them up.
Nick.
I just want to say hello to everybody that plays there. I'm sure a lot of you guys are watching. Now back from the guys back in 95 on the guys have played over the last few years. An absolute pleasure. Getting old, I'm getting sore. I'm going to move on.
How dare he interrupt me like that? Who does he think he is?
He's about the only one who could do that.
Arianis has a completion. Dwight Carter over the middle, Earl Riley with the stop. I think if Scott Couper could have written his own script today, it would have gone something like this.
Oh, I tell you what, again, I sat down and talked to him yesterday, and he said, hey, I don't want them to make a big deal out of this. I just want to retire. I'm still going to be involved with the Claymores football team and things like that. But, wow, what a send-off. His entire team, to a man, said we want to send him out the right way.
And a complete collision, and somehow Jason Brookins manages to bounce out of it. And how ironic that a complete busted play, that ball is dead. Could have been a disaster, turned into probably their best offensive player at a ball game.
What do you got? What do you got?
Look at this. Some chippiness here in the last 15 minutes of the season.
I think the Rhein Fire probably needed to have a little bit of that emotion in the first quarter, more so than in the fourth quarter down 34 to nothing.
Keith Miller said to me as we were down on the field, he said, tell my dad back in San Diego, wax down the surfboard and get the barbecue out. I'm coming home.
He did tell us, he said he was online, probably checking out worldbowl.com to see who's going to be playing in it, and he saw Kyle Turley, offensive line for New Orleans Saints, surfing. And he said it made him so homesick and so jealous he couldn't wait to get back to San Diego.
This is a man with a split personality, plays with real fire.
on intensity, and you meet him off the field, he's just a laid-back surf dude.
First down at the 19-yard line, the Fire trying to get that big zero off the board. Arianis from the shotgun, there's a flag in the defensive backfield, and Earl Riley makes the pick. But will it stand up? And the ball is bouncing around and recovered in the end zone by the Fire. So, and now it's been signaled a touchdown, but we've got flags everywhere as well.
What a bizarre play.
What is Earl Riley thinking?
He's a teammate of mine, and Dave Campbell would wring his neck if he did that with the Dallas Cowboys.
I think in all the shenanigans, it was Michael Lewis that got the touchdown. Let's see.
12 men on the field, on the defense. The penalty is declined. The pass was intercepted. The runner came out of the end zone, lateral back into the end zone, recovered by a player, Rhein Fire. Touchdown, Rhein.
What a way to get your first points.
And Earl Riley, we're keeping a low profile for the next few minutes.
Earl Riley, you're going to see him right here. He makes a fine defensive play, like we had said earlier. Catch the ball. They're so used to knocking the ball down. He catches the ball, makes a nice play. Go down on a knee. You're up 37, 34 to nothing. Go down on a knee.
I tell you what, Akihito Amaya did a great job of forcing that strip, though. Give Amaya some credit.
Right, he does a great job, but only after Earl Riley.
Now we got stuff going off again, and there's an official in the middle of that.
That's it, God damn it!
And no one. I think Keith Miller and Antonio Dingler certainly didn't think of that, but it's one of those things, isn't it, though, when you've been kicked around all game long, you are frustrated.
You're definitely frustrated. The thing that just really bothers me is that instead of taking the motion out while you're playing, they're doing it after the play. They're taking cheap shots, they're throwing punches, things like that don't belong on the football field. They've gone
personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 63 on the offense. The player has been ejected.
Oh, Michael Early. We talked to him last night as well, and I don't think we want to talk to him tonight.
I don't think so. Again, it just bothers me. Instead of taking the motion out between the whistles, these guys are taking cheap shots after the whistle. Now, he's going to be upset and bothered, but you've seen Rhein player after Rhein player doing things after the whistle. They came out and played like they were supposed to the first three quarters. None of this would have been going on.
Early, a 10-game starter for the Rhein Fire in their World Bowl last season.
You're going to see him right over here, a very fine center for the Rhein Fire. Again, the frustration comes in, just a simple field goal block, and after the play, the referees say, balls away, let up. He throws one of the Scotland players down and then pins him.
And from that replay, it was all Michael Early.
Yeah. There's absolutely no reason for that. There's no call for that in the game of football.
It was Keith Miller he managed to push down. Maybe there's a little retribution from that earlier bust-up. Michael Early. What's the rule? I think they've got a few minutes to compose themselves before they leave the field, but they do have to leave. I think Earl Riley might want to leave after that play. Not one of his greatest moments. But it happens.
It seems to be it's an okay thing when you're up 34-0.
So after the penalty, the Claymores should get decent field position. Dante Hall is wasting it around his own 28. James Tuthill with the kickoff. Reggie Hunt fields at the 23. And Hunt is met and stopped. Great open field tackle from Takimoto.
Go back to the field goal and you're going to see right here down at the bottom of your screen Mike Early is going to get up, and clearly after everything is done the punch happened earlier, and then he throws another punch.
Who's going to tell him to leave? You?
I'm not. Maybe that guy is.
It was real scratchy. I couldn't have
Michael Early celebrated his birthday yesterday too. Gus Ornstein is back in the game. And here's Steve Hutchinson, the Londoner, who took 4 months out of his job, took 4 months unpaid leave just to come and fulfill a dream of playing American football.
And what's so interesting and neat about this is you see guys like Stephen Hutchinson and Scott Couper and those guys coming here and just playing for the pure love of the game. They're not making millions of dollars. They're just coming out and playing because they love to play football.
There goes Michael. Happy birthday. Second down and 5. Hutchinson still in the backfield. Ornstein will get it to him again, and Hutchinson tries to move the pile forward and will get another yard. Works for an electronics company in London, Steve Hutchinson, and he loves the game so much he says he'd love to come back next year, but it's tough to get unpaid leave for 4 months of the year. It's tough to kind of pay the bills in that situation.
I would have a feeling that, you know, unless your boss is very, very generous and nice, it's awful hard to go to him and say, you know what, I enjoy my job and I'm leaving for about 4 or 5 months. Would you give me a little unpaid leave of absence?
Third down and 3. Ornstein just sidearms it to Stephen Fontana, and Fontana is going to be short of first down yardage. Gang tackle there. We're all there. Deke Cooper, Clarence LeBlanc, and a bunch of others. I think he's just short. They may bring the chains out on that one. He's got a very generous spot, but I still think he's just a little bit short.
They gave him a nice forward progress spot there. It's going to be a little bit closer than either you or I thought.
Well, this would really rub the Rhein fire's face in it if this was a first down. That's a very generous spot. He looked a good yard short, didn't he, at first? Well, they're coming off and standing on the punting unit. Conservative to the last, Gene Darquist, and he makes no apology for it.
No, he doesn't, and I tell you what, he did. He let the reins out a little bit today. They had a great two-minute drill there at the end of the first half. You know, you run it in practice against air. You just go out there and practice it, make your calls. There's no defense out there. They ran that two-minute drill like they had practiced it and done it so well. And then he also called the double throwback to Clint Stoerner. That's kind of a chancy play. Yeah. So he has come out of his shell a little bit. Maybe next year he'll be able to build on this.
It's definitely showed what happens when you loosen up the play calling a bit. That's for sure. Dwight Carter waits at his 12 for Brad Costello's punt. Wells and his quarters of 13, and Carter looks to cut inside. We've got a flag down. We've got a big collision down there as well. But this may be coming back as well. Wow, we've got a bit more chippiness down on the field. Derek Gardner involved in something with Lonnie Mitchell. There it is, the one that says it's coming back.
During the return, holding number 36, the receiving team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
Sean Mallard assessed, 11 minutes, 12 seconds left. The Claymores still in the driving seat. Nick Halling along with Dale Hellestray at Hampden Park in Glasgow, witnessing the final act of the season for the Scottish Claymores. Not quite the season these Claymores fans wanted, but if you're going to leave them on a high.
What a final act it's been for the entire Claymore team.
First down. Who's in at quarterback now for Far? Is it Arianis? It might as well be you, quite frankly, the way they play today. They're giving it to Jason Brookins, who takes full advantage of a very big hole, and Brookins will pick up 16 yards. Earl Riley and Reggie Hunt on the stop. Brookins, a guy who got injured earlier in the season just as he was hitting his stride, and that certainly hurt the Fire offensively back in about week 4.
Right, but you know what? Scotland's going to let them run the ball as many times as they want to. They can run it all the way down the field, 10-yard chunk. The time's running off the clock.
Scotland goes to the 4-man line. Arianis with lots of time to find J.J. Huggins, the tight end. There's another member of the Dallas Cowboys. He was in camp with you guys last year, and you think he's going to be battling James Whalen for a job possibly next season.
I'll tell you what, if you just look at their two seasons, Whalen is exactly what the Cowboys are looking for. They want to see a pass catching tight end. J.J. Hugg is more of a blocking type tight end, although he made a nice catch there. Nice little run after the catch.
So you have to be nice about so many people, don't you? Because you're going to be sharing a training camp with them in a few weeks. I'm going to get you to say something bad about somebody, Dale. No, not really. Second and short. Still with that four-man front, the Claymores movement. I think Chris Ward might have jumped. No flag, though. And they're going for Michael early and early. Michael Lewis, excuse me, shows his speed. The fastest guy on the Rhein fire picks up his second touchdown of the game. Something to shout about at last for the traveling fans.
That's what both Joe Clark and Coach Garchik called us. Look for you got to look for Mike Lewis to make some big plays. We're going to be going to him. We expect him to pick up the slack for Hardaway. Only they wanted this to happen in the first quarter rather than the fourth quarter.
But the way Michael Lewis sprinted clear of those defensive backs, it shows he's got killer speed.
Okay, now we're done here.
Manfred Bergsmuller, the 51-year-old German former soccer player, takes on the extra point. It's 34-14.
Right here, you're going to have Earl Riley come up. He's instead of making a play on the reach, on the ball, he tries to take the receiver, Mike Lewis, out. He misses, and when you're the safety, you're the last line of defense. It's a touchdown when you got as much speed as Mike Lewis does.
So, two quick touchdowns for Michael Lewis. That one, a 64-yarder after he recovered the Earl Riley fumble just a few moments ago. Earl Riley's not having the greatest of fourth quarters here, is he?
No, he has his struggled just a little bit here in the fourth quarter. And, you know, you don't, again, things have gone so well for Scotland. You don't want your fourth quarter to just get all haphazard and make a bunch of silly mistakes, because that's what you're going to remember as you're going off the field.
Look at this, Scott Couper looks like he's going back as a kickoff return man now.
I'm sure they're expecting an onside kick from the Rhein fire here. They would have done it on the last kickoff, but with the 15-yard unsportsmanlike conduct penalty, there's no way that you're going to onside kick from your own 15-yard line. I'm sure with the way the score is, the time, they need to get the ball back.
James Tuthill, kicker, the ordained minister from California. Right now the fire need all the help they can get. That one sails into an unguarded end zone and out. Well, next week it's the World Bowl. The Barcelona Dragons will be playing somebody. We don't know who. It could yet be the Rhein fire. It's more likely to be the Berlin Thunder. It could even be the Amsterdam Admirals. You can see it on Fox if you're in the United States. You can see it on Sky Sports if you're in the UK. You can see it all around the world as well. You'll be there, Dale, doing it for our colleagues in the United Kingdom, Sky Sports.
Looking forward to it. I have not been a part of the World Bowl experience, but everything I've heard about it is as exciting and fun as you're going to find.
If you don't have fun at the World Bowl, Dale, you're in the wrong game, believe me. It's a lot of fun. First down, Scotland, number 20, Ornstein, gives it to Vaughan Sanders.
We're done.
Pick up 6 yards, Deke Couper on the stop. Well, Deke Couper making the tackle there, leads the league with 6 interceptions. He's really not been any kind of factor today. Deke, we asked him about that name, didn't we? Deke, you know, his real name is Jonathan, but Deke is short for Del Vecchio, and I can't work that one out yet.
And he's not sure where it came from. He didn't answer to Del Vecchio, so they just started calling him Deke, and he did respond to that.
Whatever. Second down and 5, Ornstein will throw. He's got Corey Allen. Allen spins away from Corey Harris and will pick up 8 yards, and they'll move the chains. Ronnie Nix and Masaki Tokimoto pushing him out of bounds. And Ornstein goes back into a training camp at Kansas City and would have loved a bit more playing time. He hasn't really been given an opportunity to show what he can do.
Yeah, the thing is, he's him and Stoerner were kind of locked in a battle, and Stoerner's drawn the first, third, and fourth quarters. Ornstein knew that early in the season that that was going to work out. He has got some playing time. And you know what? He's going to go in next month, and he's going to give it his best shot.
Lonnie Mitchell and Corey Allen, the wideouts.
Sanders has got nowhere to go, and he's looking to try and make something happen. And eventually picks up 5 yards to Sean Mallard and Klaus LeBlanc on the stop.
Jay Humphrey now, you're going to take... He's our left tackle. Talking to him both last week and this week. He's a big, huge guy. He's married to this little golfer, Kelly Keeney, who's on the Women's LPGA Tour. Finished 8th at the Women's U.S. Open. They golf together sometimes. He said he's beaten her one time. She won't ever admit it publicly, but he said he did beat her
Got
one
him.
Time.
Got him, Pete.
He has no witnesses, of course. Ornstein gives it to Sanders, who picks up another yard.
It's interesting because, you know, I was golfing here in Scotland the other day with another couple people, and they see a big guy walk up onto the first tee, and they expect you to hit it a mile and be able to be a good golfer.
How many miles did you hit it?
I hit it about a mile straight and then a mile to the right, which doesn't bode well for your golf game.
Our game director today, Mike Frank, was bragging about 154 holes in 4 days or something like that.
I think it was 154 he shot in one round.
That's more like it. We are now getting abuse in our ears from our director. Third down, Ornstein will take off and show some fleetness of foot, and you can forget that.
Okay.
Galen Hyder on the stop. Ornstein, very much a pocket passer. He says, if you get me running around, you're in trouble. You've got to know your strengths.
Well, you do, and a man needs to know his limitations, and he's very aware of those. He just did that because he didn't want to make a stupid mistake and put his team in trouble.
So Andre Cooper retreats. Brad Costello back out once again. Still 20 points the advantage with less than 7 minutes remaining. Could still possibly get interesting if the Fire were to get a quick one here. Fielded by Cooper, and he gets all the way up to the 18-yard line. 6:33 left here in Hampden Park. And tomorrow on Fox is Winston Cup Racing live with the Dodge Safemart 350 from the Sears Point Raceway. Watch as Jeff Gordon looks to repeat last year's mastery of the hills and twists of this Sonoma County track and bring home the checkered flag once again. Coverage begins tomorrow at 3 p.m. Eastern, 12 Pacific on Fox. The Fox Networks, your home for NASCAR. And being a Brit, NASCAR doesn't mean a whole lot to me, but I hear it's kind of a religion over there.
Yeah, I tell you what, it's absolutely huge, especially in the southeastern United States. And our good friend John Madden's going to be doing the gentleman start your engine, so you know there'll be a little excitement there.
Oh, I thought he was going to race. Mariannis goes down and loses the football. They're ruling it dead. Lucky for Arianis, I think he got a break. Bryant Shaw made the hit. Another guy that's going to the Cowboys. Where are all these Cowboys coming from?
We got a whole load of them over here, don't we?
It's ridiculous.
Well, now, right now, is the favorite part of the game for a defensive lineman. When you've got a big lead, you know they're going to throw the ball. You can absolutely care less if they run the ball for another 80 yards. You're going for sacks right now.
Loss of 4 on the play. Clock continues to run. Jason Brookins gets not much. Keith Miller puts off the surf for another few minutes. But his bags are packed. He's ready to hit the waves.
The Scotland defense all day long has been putting pressure on both Rhein quarterbacks, doesn't matter who they throw in there. And you look at this stat right here, 6 sacks for the Scotland defense. The Rhein Fire has none, which right there in a nutshell tells you how well Scotland's playing.
Is Arianis on third and long, pursued by Rob Blickinger, but Arianis gets it away. And a great diving catch made by Andre Cooper. Nate Terry had the coverage. Cooper, who had a baby just 3 days ago, back home in Jacksonville, Florida. He went home, funnily enough, last week. His wife was due last week, and she didn't have it, so he had to come back, and he's missed the birth.
But again, the internet works wonders. He saw a picture of his baby boy, Andre II.
That's beautiful. Arianis, first down from the gun. No one home. Looked in the general direction of... And now a flag does come in, after Dwight Carter complained. That was a very late flag.
It was very late. Looked like there was, again, miscommunication between the receiver and the quarterback.
Well, it's a penalty against the Claymores.
Holding, number 29 on defense, 5-yard penalty, automatic. First down.
Central McClellan does the disbelieving look.
And the reason that there looked like there's miscommunication between the quarterback and the wide receiver is right here. You're going to see McClellan holding on. Therefore, there's no way you're going to complete the ball when Dwight Carter's being held like that.
First down at the 35. The Fire still looking for a miracle here. Arianis, though, is shaking off some of this rust. There's the completion to Carter. Carter falls forward at the 41-yard line. Terry and Whitfield on the stop. It's interesting to see how Arianis has settled down a bit. I know they're playing a very, very prevent defense now, but Arianis is looking a bit more comfortable in there now.
Much more so, and if he would have had another week or two to get involved in the offense and get to play with these wide receivers, I'm sure you'd have seen a whole different offense.
There's another completion. It's J.J. Huggins again, and they're starting to really move down the field now. Far too late, surely. Keith Miller on the stop from the big tight end.
The Scotland defense now, they're going to give Arianis all the short passes he wants. He's going to end up with fairly decent stats for the day, but as long as the clock keeps running, as it is right now, it's down to 4 minutes left in the game, they'll do this.
There it goes again. Huggins once more shoved out of bounds. No, he stayed in. And Huggins stopped by Blenman and then loses the football. Oh. Who's got that? What is going on? No, somehow Huggins has come up with that. There's four Claymores and J.J. Huggins, who looked like he'd been pushed out of bounds, then found some more. It's been interesting today, Dale.
Well, I tell you what, we have seen some things that we have not seen before. It's the J.J. Huggins show here. We're going to see him do just a quick little out. Again, about a 5-yard pattern. They're just looking to move the chains. But what he does here is Scotland thinks he's going to run out of bounds and stop the clock. He sees there's open field. He's got a clear pass to the end zone. Keith Miller comes in and knocks the ball out somehow. J.J. Huggins ends up with the ball under all that massy humanity.
J.J. Huggins just letting everybody know there is more than one Dallas Cowboys tight end in this ball game.
J.J. Huggins is almost an offensive tackle in a tight end body, and to see him out there on the sideline, you know, opening up his stride a little bit, trying to put a move on somebody, he's better off just lowering his head, trying to get into the end zone.
Less than 4 minutes left. Call me silly. If the Rhein Fire get a touchdown really quick here, it's going to get interesting, isn't it?
Onside kick, and who knows? I mean, the interesting thing about the onside kick is it's all weighted towards the team that's doing the onside kick. All the rules are in their favor, so you score a touchdown here. That's why they make the rules that way. The people in the NFL are pretty smart.
And it would just sow some seeds of doubt if they went in here. Arianis trying to work a miracle. Draw some coverage. Can't find Adam Newman, who makes the catch about 5 yards out. And Joe Clark tells us he loves Adam Newman, this tight end who's allocated here from the Green Bay Packers, but they never use him. He's only had 5 catches all season long.
Yeah, well, you know what? I think really the only person that's really had a successful season receiving-wise is probably Hardaway, and he's played the last 2 games banged up. The offense as a whole has struggled, especially down the stretch. So looking at any types of stats is probably going to be a little bit misleading as to how talented each of the players are.
Second down and goal from the 7. Brookins is the motion man. Arianis is looking. And that was broken up. It was almost picked off. Zarianis tried to force it, and Keith Miller almost had it. Third and goal.
Keith Miller having a nice season. Would have really liked to wrap it up with an interception there. That would have been awful nice on his part. He could have taken that ball home with him to San Diego and maybe tied it to the edge of his surfboard.
Third and goal. If they don't get it here, you can be sure they'll go for it on fourth down too. Arianis gets some pressure and doesn't have anybody home. And now it's fourth and goal. Chris Ward applying the pressure. What a season Chris Ward has had.
Chris Ward has had a wonderful season. He's a little bit older, sat out and talked with him yesterday. He came in and talking to him versus all the other guys, you could tell there was a little bit of a different maturity level with him. He came in calm and cool, collected. He said he wanted to come in this year, and there are a few things that he wanted to work on. He said he wanted to work on his leadership. He said that was one thing that really coming in this year. He said, hey, last year I came here, I got to see all the sights and all the sounds of Europe and all that. He said, this year I want to work on my leadership, and I want to focus and finish. You know, it's interesting because I was talking to him, we were in the defensive line meeting room, and looking up on the board and seeing all the little different sayings and things like that, their offensive line coach, Jim Tomsula, really has helped Chris Ward this year. Chris Ward gives him a bunch of credit for helping him with his pass rush moves, for being able to get as many sacks as he has this year, and he's hoping he's going to catch on. He said there's been some teams that have shown some interest, and I have a feeling he'll be on somebody's roster this coming year.
Fourth down and goal, and a timeout called by Antonio Dingle of the Claymores. So a chance for Jim Arianis to go and talk this one over with Joe Clark.
I asked Chris Ward, I said, you know, what are some of the things you've learned? He said, well, you know what? For Coach Tomsula, one of the things he taught me was how to watch film. He said, you know what? You can watch an offensive lineman, his stance, backfield set, things like that. And what he told him is that if you watch the offensive lineman, they're going to be like your mom. They're never going to trick you. They're going to lead you to the ball. He said the backfield and quarterback, they're going to try and trick you a lot. But if you keep your eye on those offensive linemen, 95% of the time, they're going to lead you right to the ball.
There's the voice of maturity right there.
Change it to a 990 fade out. Try to come to the tall guy over here, Cooper.
The tall guy is Andre Cooper, number 80.
You hear a 9-9 fade out, that means they're going to try and throw a fade to the tall guy, which would be Cooper.
Brookins in the backfield, fourth and goal, four wide receivers in. They go the other way, looking for Lewis again. Incomplete. And that surely is that for the Rhein Fire.
Nick, I think that's the hardest play in football. Throwing fades down in the end zone, the ball has to be perfect. The receiver has to be taller, bigger, stronger than the cornerback, because the cornerback knows it's coming. Everything has to work out perfect for that play to work.
And all Jim Arianis can do is hope he gets another opportunity next week in the World Bowl.
I know, that was my first thought. I should have just went with this.
Boy, if the Fire do somehow get there, and they still could with a Berlin self-destruct in Amsterdam tomorrow, they have got some serious regrouping to do. Steve Hutchinson getting
okay,
his
we're done.
Extended workout. He'll pick up a couple more.
We talked to the coaches, you talked to the players from the Rhein Fire, and they have a dinner plan tomorrow night. They're going to sit down and they're going to have dinner and they're going to watch the game tomorrow to see, you know, almost like an NCAA tournament selection show to see if they're going to get to go to the World Bowl. It's going to be a whole different team sitting down there eating tomorrow in Dusseldorf.
This is not a nice man to be around when you've lost as well.
I can't imagine he is, and I can't imagine many coaches that are. It's, you know, because they come over here, and it's a great proving ground for not only the players, officials, announcers, but also the coaches.
Well, that race for the World Bowl will go down to some very complex tiebreakers. The Claymores are probably wishing they were in that picture. They're not. Hutchinson draws a crowd and no more. Julian Duncan has changed his shirt now, wears number 90 on the stop. Well, the first ruling is head-to-head, but everybody's won at home and lost on the road. So after that, it goes down to combined rankings. As you can see, Berlin and Rhein at the moment ranked 8th. That's number 2 offensively, number 6 defensively for Berlin. Those numbers won't move for Berlin, whatever. And the Fire, 4-4, that too makes 8. They may drop another ranking, which would really put Berlin in good shape. Amsterdam are in trouble there, as you can see. They need to do some pretty heavy moving.
Exactly. And then the final tiebreaker, it goes to a flip of the coin.
Well, no, there's the points differential before that, which also favors Berlin.
Okay, and then the after that, a flip of the coin, which you don't want to see happen.
Pete Kuharczyk would take a flip of a coin right now if you gave it to him.
Talking to him yesterday, he said, "I don't care about tiebreakers." Well, you know what? On the flight home, he's going to be trying to figure out every tiebreaker he can find.
Got him, Pete, got him!
Third down and six. Fontana is the motion man. And Hutchinson gets the carry once again, and Steve Hutchinson shows a good pair of heels. Flag comes in late. There's a guy that's been enjoying himself. But will it stand up? And I'll tell you, if this is an offensive hold, and it is, Steve Hutchinson's going to have some words.
I think they're going to get Fontana on the hold here.
During the run, holding number 88 on the offense.
That is Steve Fontana.
Half the distance to the goal. Repeat, third down.
Hutchinson making a nice run. He's getting a few carries here in the fourth quarter and being able to show a little something. He's got a little speed, a little burst to him that might bode well for him to be able to have a little success.
So less than 3 minutes to go here now. Third down and nine. Three wide receivers in. Ornstein puts it on the ground again, and Hutchinson looks to work it and gets it again. And this time there's no flag. 15 yards. And you see running like this, I know it's at the end of the game, and you kind of think, well, why didn't this guy get a look earlier?
You know what's interesting is they play a four-man line, Ryan does. But right here, you're going to see Kelly Gregg standing up as a linebacker. He's about a 305-pound defensive lineman. He says he's the fastest and quickest interior defensive lineman they have, and he enjoys standing up, playing a little bit of linebacker. I think he'd have been better off down in a three-point stance there.
First down as we move to the two-minute warning. Oh, dear, that ball is loose. And it's been recovered by the Fire, and they're going to go in again. Touchdown, Rhein Fire, Kelly Gregg. What a reversal of fortune. Hutchinson clobbered, lost the ball, and Gregg has kept this game alive.
That's exactly what we were talking about. The Rhein Fire right back in it. The defensive line of Rhein actually beat Hutchinson to the ball. Galen Hyder is going to be through the offensive line of Scotland before the ball can even be handed off.
That's wiped a few smiles off the face. Manfred Bergsmuller, the old man of NFL Europe.
Okay, we're...
He's done his job, and suddenly 13 points in it with just over 2 minutes left. And who would have believed this? I don't think he would.
No, I don't think anybody would have believed it. But that's why you play the game, and I've always said this. You play the football game no matter who's favored, who's the best team. It's always who plays the best on that particular day.
Five defensive touchdowns now for Pete Kuharczyk's Fire.
You're going to see the interior of the defensive line right here. They're going to explode through the gaps in the Claymore offensive line and actually basically intercept the handoff. You can see Hutchinson saw Hyder there, putting the pressure on him, tried to cut before he actually had the ball. The handoff was muffed. And Kelly Gregg showing a little nimbleness getting into that zone.
Well, Kelly Gregg goes back to the Baltimore Ravens after this, of all places to go and try and get a job as a defensive guy.
But yes, especially on that interior line, because they have a awesome defense, and in particular, defensive line.
Here's the onside kick from Tuthill, and Stephen Fontana is there, and he successfully gets hold of that. So crisis over for Scotland, but they've made heavy going of this in the fourth quarter.
I guess maybe they just didn't want the fans to leave. They wanted them to hang around and see Scott Cooper's final final minutes as a Claymore, and you end up winning 34 to nothing. People start heading for the exit a little bit early.
So the Scottish Claymores at the 40-yard line of the Rhein Fire. They're in somber mood, aren't they?
The great thing about Scott Couper, you know, you're talking to him yesterday, I had a hard time understanding him at the beginning because he's so excitable and loves to talk, but he said he feels he's playing his best football of his career this year. And to be able to walk away on top really means something to him.
Ornstein gives it back to Hutchinson. Hutchinson
okay,
has lost his magic touch. Just a 1 yard run there. And that takes us to 2 minutes left of the regular season. With the Claymores leading it 34-21. We'll be back for the final act in a moment.
He saw it coming, but oh, you don't know how cold that is, because it's cold up there too. But, you know, I think Scott Cooper's last game had a lot to do with the way the Claymores came out.